Now, what we'll try and analyze in the next 10 minutes is essentially this diagnostic conundrum that you will meet in sports cardiology. It's following on what Professor Sharma was just describing to you about anterior tube with inversion, is the differentiation between ARVC and athletic adaptation to exercise. And one obvious reason why you may have such a gray zone will be the anterior T wave inversions that were just described to you. And the other reason is the right ventricular dilatation. And commonly, in the context of screening, you will have anterior T wave inversions, you will proceed to further investigations, and then you will find the right ventricular dilatation, and then you're a bit of a trouble. So I'll present it through a case. So we've got a 22-year-old Caucasian rugby player who trains 13 hours a week. This is his 12th lead ECG, so he attended one of the CRICE screenings. And as you can clearly see, his ECG demonstrates predominantly that feature that I want to focus on, which is anterior T-wave inversion. So this is T-wave inversion beyond V2, going to V3. And based on what Professor Sharma said, we must be concerned because he is post-pubertal white athlete. Now, this is also the cardinal sign of arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. And this is a very challenging condition to diagnose, and we'll have more details about ARVC by Professor Corrado later on. But essentially, you've got fibrofatty replacement of your heart muscle, predisposition to arrhythmias. And if you want one condition that's clearly associated with sudden cardiac death during exercise and in athletes, that's arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy, okay? Now, the other things that we've clearly know from arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy is that intense exercise is associated with higher penetrance, lower age of presentation, high risk of ventricular arrhythmias, and more rapid progression to heart failure. And that's the fact even in genotype positive, phenotype negative individuals, so those who have not yet expressed the disease. And that's a very important point because that means that we've got a duty to get it right. So if we look about the diagnosis of arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy, I'll very briefly say to you, because I'm sure it will be reported later on, that there is a number of diagnostic criteria, so you need a comprehensive evaluation. Imaging is part of that diagnostic criteria, and here I've just put a couple of values for you to remember. On the cardiac MRI, volume of 110 mL per meter square is part of your major diagnostic criteria. But remember, it's not just right ventricular dilatation that you need. You also need to have a degree of regional wall motion abnormalities, whether it's dyskinetic, akinetic, or aneurysmal. So it's not just a dilatation. But keep in mind that if you take our athlete, for example, based on the fact alone that he's got anterior T-wave inversions, he already has a possible diagnosis of arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. So, if we go to his transthoracic echocardiogram, what you can see on these views and on the measurements I've got here for you is that his left ventricle is quite dilated, 68 millimeters. We can accept anything up to 70 millimeters based on the study by Antonio Pelliccia. His right ventricle is significantly dilated as well. RVD1, the base, the inflow is 54 millimeters. And I've put the outflow measurement there for you because that's the measurement that it's used on the echocardiographic criteria of the ARVC task force diagnostic criteria. Otherwise, diastology and systolic function is within normal limits. Now, if you take that value that I had here for you, the 45 millimeters, and you look at the study that Abbas Zaidi published in our group, look at RV dimensions in athletic individuals. On the top, you've got male versus female. At the bottom, you've got white versus black. There are two points to make. One, a significant proportion with overlap with the dimension criteria of arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. And remember that our athlete will fall around that 45, so he will fall at the fringes of what we will consider normal within that big cohort that Abbas reported. Now, you may say, well, it's not the same sport, so I've put here a study by another fellow that was funded by cardiac risk in the young, Lisin Forsyth, who worked with David Oxborough from Liverpool. And what they did is they looked at about 150 rugby players, okay? And exactly the same message. Almost 40% plus overlap with major diagnostic criteria, distance-wise. Our athlete will fall again at the fringes of what's considered normal for a big rugby player. And the other important messages that Lindsay said and David Oxborough is the fact that the ratio may be an important discriminator, and you see that RV to LV ratio was 0.9, a bit higher compared to the control, so there seems to be a bit of a preferential dilatation of the RV compared to the LV, but fairly symmetrical. And another point that you may use every now and then is how much the outflow tract dilates compared to your inflow, and the ratio is similar, about 0.8, 0.9. Now, if we move to the cardiac MRI, which is what you will usually do in such a circumstance, the MRI doesn't really add much to what we know already. We will do the cardiac MRI because it will give us a more accurate estimate of the volumes. It will assess regional wall motion abnormalities. We can look for the presence of myocardial fibrosis. But what his MRI says is that the LV is significantly dilated. These are normal values for sedentary individuals, okay? The RV is dilated a bit more than the LV. Look at his stroke volumes, about 170 mLs, okay? And the ejection fraction, both the right and the left, will be what I call the lower limits of normal. And he didn't have any significant myocardial fibrosis, okay? Now, if we go and look at MRI studies, there is this meta-analysis that included about 1,000 competitive athletes. Obviously, a meta-analysis of 27 small studies has its advantages and its disadvantages because you've got a very heterogeneous populations. But what I would like to highlight is that look at the normal values they reported. The 99th centile falls above the 110 that is reported in the diagnostic ARVC criteria. So the great majority of your athletes by MRI will be above that baseline. Important point. Second important point, this is clearly associated with how much exercise do you do. The more you do, the greater the dilatation of your right ventricle. And in this particular cohort, they also pointed out that the right ventricular function, the ejection fraction, was not particularly impaired. So it was within that lower limits of normal. Now, this is a very nice study by Bracken, and what he did is he looked at a more homogeneous population of young athletic individuals. And the message here is that look at those values. End-diastolic volumes corrected for BSA of 144, okay, and up to 175, the 95th centile. So our athlete will fall with that, but this is significantly dilated compared to your regular athletes or compared to sedentary individuals. And the same goes for women. They also get similar sort of dilatation. However, determinants was gender, so males tend to have more dilated ventricles compared to females. And as we said before, the hours of exercise per week. Important difference in this study compared to the previous one, that they did actually have a significant proportion, about 10% of athletes, who exhibited impaired or mildly impaired right ventricular function with ejection fraction in the area of 40 to 45%, which will overlap with the minor but not with the major ARVC criteria. Now, before I finish, I would like briefly to mention this very nice study that was published by Abbas Zaidi from our group. Abbas did exactly and took exactly athletes like the ones I've reported. So athletes who have anterior T-wave inversions and were investigated comprehensively. Compare them with athletes with no T-wave inversions and patients with ARVC that he tried to keep them to similar age and gender. Now, few important messages. Look at the left ventricular dimensions, okay? Athletes have more dilated ventricles compared to ARVC patients. You may say no surprise there. Look at the right ventricle. Athletes had similar right ventricles with the pathology, the ARVC. Look at the right ventricular ejection fraction. For the great majority of athletes, it was preserved compared to patients with the RVC. And look at the RV end-diastolic volume compared to the LV end-diastolic ratio, which was about 1 compared to 1.24 for patients with the RVC. To summarize that study, in very nice histograms that Abbas presented, if you look at the task force criteria, you take ejection fraction, Rarely athletes will go below 45%, and extremely rare to go below 40%, which is a major diagnostic criterion for ARVC. And if you look at ratios, guys, the 1.2 ratio will differentiate the great majority of athletic individuals compared to patients with arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. So just to summarize, if you want to differentiate athletes' heart from ARVC, and that's on the imaging criteria, because we also have to remember that A is for arrhythmia, so exercise testing and Holter monitoring plays a very important role. I'll say that absolute values are a poor discriminator. If you've got a ratio on your echocardiogram of less or equal than 1, that's probably normal. On your MRI, less or equal than 1.2. And the things to be concerned about will be ratios above that, impaired ventricular function or significantly impaired ventricular function, and obviously the presence of myocardial fibrosis and wall motion abnormalities. So just to summarize, I would like to say that when you're evaluating people with dilated ventricles and anterior T wave inversions, you will probably have to relate to your whole armamentarium of investigations before you make a decision as to what is athletic adaptation or ARVC. Very important message, look at the left ventricle. This is the experience that Chris Miles published from Mary Shepherd's and the CRI Center of Cardiac Pathology. It's not really ARVC, it's arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy. And you all know that we're much better at evaluating wall motion abnormalities, myocardial fibrosis, more detailed tissue characterization on the left compared to the right side. So don't forget the left ventricle. And if you're interested in sports cardiology, come and speak to me. We run an MSc program at St. George's University of London. Thank you very much for your attention.